See, when Glenn asked me if I wanted to preach for this Sunday, I was really excited. I was like, yeah, man, all for it. I'll do it. Then he asked me, he's like, well, Mikey, you know, you can borrow one of my sermons. And I was like, well, Glenn, I don't want people falling asleep during my sermon. So I don't want that happening around here. So I was like, I got to make sure I got to write my own sermon. We don't want that happening. Just kidding, guys. That didn't happen. Glenn's like, never letting Mikey speak again. It's not happening. We are going to be in Matthew 13, verses 44 through 46 this morning. I just want to take a couple minutes before I get into this, because when I get into the Word, I really want this to be about Jesus. I don't want this to be about me. But I really want to thank you, this church. This church has been, I'm going to try to say this without crying. This church has been a process of sanctifying me. It has been a process of being a family in this church. One of the things I realized really quickly was that this church isn't like most churches. You don't come in, say hi to a few people, then leave. No, it's like, hey, let's have dinner, let's have lunch. I ate a lot of food at a lot of different people's houses, and I thank you guys for that. I will miss this church immensely. God knows that. If I didn't have to leave, I wouldn't. But I know this is what God's calling me to do, is to go to school and get prepared, get equipped. I will miss this church. I will miss Brother Glenn and Jerry, the love that they've lavished on me. I will miss the friendships that I made here from Josh and Trent. And I will miss the handshakes from Greg Sullivan that make me feel like I'm a four-year-old girl. I will miss this church so much. There's so many people that I could say thank you for, but the Lord knows I can't. If I said everybody's name, it would take too much time. My sermon would be done. We don't want that. So let's pray. Let's ask God to get our hearts and our minds right for what he has for us in his word. Father, we come before you today. We're going to be reading through your word. We want you to teach us from it. Lord, we want to see you for what you are, Lord. Not for what we think you are, but what your word says you are. Lord, help us see that this morning. Help me to speak clearly, Lord. I pray that you'll just speak through me today. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. So like I said, we're going to be in Matthew 13, verses 45 through 46. I'm going to go ahead and read that. It says, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field." And then another parable, verse 45, "Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one pearl of great value, went and sold all that he had." You see, Jesus often spoke in parables to his people. And he would speak in parables, and what he'd do is he'd make these comparisons, and that's what he's doing here. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure. And in the other parable, the kingdom of heaven is like a pearl, a great pearl of great value. So we see very closely that Jesus is putting this immense value on the kingdom of heaven. And the question that brought me to ask, well, what is the kingdom of heaven? Was the kingdom of heaven a destination? That's what it sounds like, doesn't it? The kingdom of heaven is this far-off land and that we will go to when we die. But when we look at verses in Matthew 6:33, and I think we have those on the screen, it says this, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be provided for you." You see, Matthew would often refer to the kingdom of God as the kingdom of heaven, because we have to remember his audience. He was speaking to Jewish culture, and in Jewish culture, it was sacred to say the name God. So he would often say kingdom of heaven instead of kingdom of God. And if we look at this verse, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be provided for you," in this passage, he is talking about not to be worried. Well, how, if the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God is some far-off destination, then how does that bring us any comfort to say, seek first the kingdom of God, this far-off destination in the future, and that's righteousness, and then all things will be provided for you? I don't know about you guys, but that doesn't give me a whole lot of comfort. Or we look at a passage in Mark 1:15 where it says this, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." I don't know about you guys, but if this is heaven, I think we got the short end of the stick. If this is heaven, that's what it's saying. The kingdom of God is here. It's now. And if we're in it, man, this doesn't look like what Revelation says it's going to look like. This doesn't look like what all the apostles were like so excited about. No, this isn't the kingdom of heaven. So what is the kingdom of heaven? Well, the kingdom of heaven is God's rule or his reign through the redemptive work of Jesus Christ. George Eldon Ladd puts it like this. When the word refers to God's kingdom, it always refers to his reign, his rule, his sovereignty, and not the realm in which it is exercised. Psalm 103:19, the Lord has established his throne in the heavens, and the kingdom rules over all. God's kingdom is his universal rule, his sovereignty over all the earth. The kingdom of God is his kingship, his rule, his authority. When this once is realized, we can go through the New Testament and find passage after passage where this meaning is evident, where the kingdom is not a realm or a people, but God's reign. Jesus said that we must receive the kingdom of God as little children. Well, what is received? The church? Heaven? No, what is received is God's rule. And in order to enter the future realm of the kingdom, one must submit himself in perfect trust to God's rule and reign now. See, the kingdom of heaven, it's not some far-off destination. No, it's now. The kingdom of heaven is here. It's now. It's the God's rule and his reign through the redemptive work of Jesus Christ. Jesus lived the perfect life, died on the cross for the sins of the world, and then was raised again. It is through him we can live in obedience with the Lord. Is it through him where the Spirit indwells us and where God's rule and his reign is now in our lives? That is what is being said here. Yes, God is always ruling and reigning, but what this passage is specifically talking about is God's rule and his reign in the hearts of sinful men. That's what it's talking about. But we also see, so now that we've clarified what the kingdom of heaven is, what we must dive into is Jesus doesn't speak lightly of the kingdom of heaven, but he equates it to great value in verses 44 and 45. He says this, the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. Well, in this time period, they didn't have banks like we do. Like now we can take pictures on our phones and deposit our checks. That wasn't possible back then. They didn't have like iPhone 1, iPhone 2. No, we live in a time period where we can go, yes, deposit check, it's done. They were like, no, let me put my treasure in a box and go dig it up a field and then put it there, hide it. Hopefully no one finds it. And if they do, there goes my life savings. Then we see again in the next parable, Jesus equating the kingdom of heaven of finding a pearl of great value. You see, in both these parables, Jesus didn't speak lightly of the kingdom of heaven. Jesus knows that the kingdom of heaven, God's rule and his reign in our lives, is very valuable. And in God's rule and his reign in our lives, that's where we get to obey God. Jesus knew that. So we've discovered what the kingdom of heaven is. Now let's look at the reaction that these men have to the kingdom of heaven. In the first parable, the man finds it in a field, and then he sells all he has just to buy the field. And then in the next parable, the man is in search of pearls. He's searching for something. And in his search for pearls, he finds one pearl of great value and says, all I have is worth this one pearl. This one pearl is greater than anything I have. You see, Jesus was saying, this should be our reaction to the kingdom of heaven. That our reaction should be a total abandon of everything else, saying, yes, Jesus is worth it all. Jesus is worth everything I have. Jesus is more valuable than anything I own. Now, a lot of you parents and a lot of you are like, well, there's not much in life that's worth everything I have. Some of you are like, well, my friends are worth everything I have. My family. Some of your parents are like, well, I would pay you to take my kids, like get those away from me, right? But there's not much in life that's worth all we have. But that's exactly what Jesus is saying here. And we got to understand that these two men probably heard things like, really? You're giving up all you have for that? That doesn't look very good. Or really? That's worth all you have? You're going to go sell all you have for that land over there? not realizing that the treasure in the field and the pearl of great value was more valuable than anything else that they would ever find. And they realized that. See, we listen to the words of Paul in Philippians 3:8, and he says this, I consider everything to be a loss in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. Because of him I have suffered the loss of all things and consider them filth so that I may gain Christ. See, what Paul was saying was everything compared to Jesus, everything compared to him is filth. Saying, all that I have, nothing compared to the Lord and through his work is nothing compared to him. Nothing compared to Jesus. You see, Jesus is not only our treasure, but he is worthy of being our treasure. Because it is through him that we can have salvation. It is through him we can have the ability to please God. We no longer have to be in rebellion. We can go, yes, oh yes, Lord, let me please you. We don't have to worry about God's Spirit being taken away from us. We can say, yes, let me enjoy you, Lord. You see, one of the things that's often for the Christian is we forget how valuable a treasure Jesus really is. We forget the very words of Paul saying everything compared to Jesus is worth nothing. But most of the time, our reaction is Jesus sometimes. Jesus sometimes, you're worth it today. Tomorrow we'll see. Depends on if I read my Bible. But the reality is, Jesus isn't a diminished treasure, but he is always a valuable treasure. And the truth is, Christians, when we forget this, it is evident in our lives. When you forget that Jesus is your treasure, it will be evident through how you live your life. The other weekend, a couple of us went to a guy's bachelor party, Brett Cook. Some of you know him. And we went to his bachelor party, and we went to a Rangers game. And me and Josh were sitting next to each other, dynamic duo, you know, can't split us up. We were sitting next to each other, and we were talking, and this guy walks in front of us, and he's just ripped. He's jacked. We're like, wow, this guy works out. And me and Josh start cracking jokes like, that's what I look like. You know, if you put me and him in a mirror, dude, like, that's exactly what I look like. And reality, people are looking at us like, okay. The truth is, if people were to look at me and they were to look at Josh, and we told them, hey, we work out, they'd be like, sure you do. Whatever helps you sleep at night. You're probably using two-pound dumbbells. Like, you need to put those things away and put on some, like, 15s. Like, start repping it out because you don't look like you work out. You see, but the guy that we saw at the game, we didn't have to go, hey, do you work out? No, it was written all over him. I mean, this guy had neck muscles on top of his neck muscles. It was ridiculous. I was like, I don't think that's possible, but somehow I'm looking at it. You see, just like working out is evident in a person, if you value Jesus Christ as your Savior, it is evident in your life. Parents, some of you want the best for your children. Well, the best for your children is for you to value Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. That is the best for your children. I never had to question my parents if they valued the Lord. Now, my parents weren't perfect, but I admire them. Because every day I could go, yes, they were pointing me back to Jesus. And whenever I finished my rebellion stage and really was ready to turn to the Lord, I knew exactly who to turn to. Mom, Dad, hey, help me value Jesus. Tell me more about him. And they were ready. Now, you can't force your kids to do anything, but setting a good example for your kids is a way to start. And graduates, let me tell you this, that there will be nothing more valuable in your life than Jesus Christ. You will search your days going, wow, I wonder all the treasures I can find. You will hear people say, well, just pursue your career, pursue money, pursue relationships. And Jesus standing there like, no, just come to me. I'm more valuable. And through me, you will get some of the things that you want. But I will be more than satisfying for you. I will be more than enough for you. You see, Jesus isn't like some pack of gum that loses its flavor. And a lot of times we treat Jesus as valuable sometimes. Only through desperate times, a lot of times. But let me tell you something. Jesus is not just sometimes satisfying and somewhat satisfying, but he is all satisfying, and he will always be satisfying. The great treasure in the field, the great pearl of great value, will never be diminished. But a lot of times, it's our mindset of him that is diminished. It's our mindset of who Jesus is that we forget and lose our view of that. See, a lot of times when we forget this, we run to these other idols saying, fulfill me, sustain me, keep me. I want you because I think that you will satisfy me. See, if you were here last Sunday night, Terry Coy did a fantastic job talking about a lot of the main idols in our culture. And I think one of the biggest idols is the idol of me. What I want. What's best for me. See, I can't imagine the frustration of God. To know your value and to see the people that you love continually run to things other than you. I can't imagine the frustration. Seeing, going, hey, look how good I am. Look at me. And the people of God are like, yeah, that was cool. This is cool. This is shiny. This is new. We forget how valuable Jesus is. See, it's no coincidence that in the book of Deuteronomy, that Moses continually pleaded with the people of God saying, please don't run to the other idols. Please don't run back to the idols. Okay, I know you're going to, but please don't. And if you do, this is the way to come back to God. Because you're going to realize, hey, that's not satisfying enough. God's more satisfying. I can't imagine this frustration. A lot of times we read the Bible and we go, wow, God is a jealous God. Well, rightfully so. How would it be to be know your value and how much you're worth and for people to look at you and go, you're not worth a penny to me? How frustrating that could be. See, when we think of jealousy in our minds, we go, I deserve that. When in reality, we don't deserve anything. Or how come they get that? Being jealous, wishing we were in their place. And God is rightfully jealous because he's going, the thing you're worshiping, that should be me. I'm worth that. Well, you're worshiping is trash, dude. It's nothing compared to me. It's nothing. You should be valuing me. That's why one of the Ten Commandments was not to run to any idols before the Lord. I love the words of John Calvin, and they're very convicting. It says this, the Lord very frequently addresses us in the character of a husband. As he performs all the offices of a true and faithful husband, so he requires love and chastity from us. That is, that we do not prostitute our souls to Satan. As the pure and chaster a husband is, the more grievously he is offended when he sees his wife inclining to a rival, so the Lord, who has betrothed us to himself in truth, declares that he burns with the hottest jealousy whenever, neglecting the purity of his holy marriage, we defile ourselves with abominable lusts, and especially with the worship of a deity, which ought to have been the most carefully kept unimpaired, and is transferred to another, or adulterated with some superstition, since in this way we not only violate our plighted troth, but defile the nuptial couch by giving access to adulterers. To sum up what he basically said is this, God very frequently addresses his church as his bride, and he is our groom. And how frustrating it must be to be the perfect husband and to see your wife continually leave and cheat on you. Some of you out here are married, and you go, wow, I can't imagine, you know you're not perfect, so I can't imagine being the perfect husband and saying, and seeing your wife leave you and go to other things, saying, what did I do wrong? Well, I didn't do anything wrong. I'm perfect. And that's what God's doing. He's going, I didn't do anything wrong. Why are you running to these things? I know what's best for you. You see, Christians, it is time that we cut out these idols of our life and treasure Jesus like that treasure he really is. And the only way we can treasure him is if we know how valuable he really is. See, a lot of times, I met a lot of college students, and it's crazy because a lot of our college students that I met on campus have a love for the Lord. They do. They love the Lord. And I've talked to some, I've been at the BSM, and I've got to talk to some, and I was like, and they were asking me questions. One of the things I told them was, you know, it's crazy. A lot of people in the older generation say that this generation, there's not a lot of believers, but I'm looking in front of me, and I'm seeing tons. But there is one thing that lacks from our generation, and it is the growth to love the Lord, to get to know Him, to open His Word. It's like we have been blinded by the devil, and we're like, yes, give me an iPad. Yes, give me the TV shows. Yes, give me everything else, but don't give me the Lord except on Sundays. You see, is that treasuring the Lord? No. That's not treasuring the Lord. Treasuring the Lord looks like these men in these parables who said, everything compared to this, what I have found, is worth nothing. They probably had families. They probably had friends. They probably had tons of money. And they were like, you know what? This treasure hidden in the field, I'm going to go sell all I have for this because it is worth it. How often do we forget this, church? You see, when I was trying to decide what I was going to preach on, there was one night, I just couldn't sleep. I was up for like hours, and topic after topic was coming in my mind of what to preach on. I was like, well, I could just tell the church how much of a blessing they've been to me. I can read something from Philippians where Paul is just so happy for the church at Philippi. And now this verse came to my mind, and I was like, yes. As much of a simple thing this is something that gets lost in the cracks for the Christian. Because I believe this, church, when just like a water hose, you're pouring out water. The Christian life without the adoration of Christ, that's what it's like. It has no purpose. It's just falling on the ground. But when we treasure Christ like the treasure He really is, it's like putting that nozzle on the water hose. All that water starts flowing in the direction with purpose, and it is going in the direction that the Lord wants. See, treasuring Christ first, that'll put everything else into its correct order. We as a church must remember this. We as a church must dwell on this. And we must as a church make this our statement and our life goal. See, the one thing that is different in both of these passages is the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field which a man found and covered up. The man kind of stumbles across this treasure. And the difference between this one and the second parable is in verse 45 it says this, and again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. See, one man was searching for something valuable, the other man stumbled across it. For a Christian, one of these is the scenario for you. You see, I look back at my life and I go, wow, I wasn't searching for some purpose in my life, but rather I kind of stumbled across Jesus and was like, yes, He's worth it. I'm going to live my life for Him. And that's a lot of you have testimony where I wasn't in search of Jesus, but He just kind of found me, you know? He just kind of found me. And that is like the man in this field. He found him. He finds this treasure, and he sells all in his joy. But some of you, in your testimonies, I was searching for something. I was searching for some sort of purpose in my life, something to show me what I'm worth, something to give me direction, give me identity. And I found Jesus Christ, and I said, yes, He is worth it all. And if you're a non-believer out here today, I want to tell you this. If you have come in here and you're like, well, you know, I didn't really know a lot about Jesus, and you know what, I kind of just showed up, but the fact is, I've kind of stumbled across this, and this great treasure that you're talking about, Mikey, he sounds amazing. You know what? He is worth it. You know what? He died for my sins. Oh, wow. I can live in obedience with him. He gives me identity. I never have to worry about, well, who am I? I can just look in his word and go, that's who I am. Because that's what my Father says I am. That's who the Creator who made me says I am. You don't ask an invention to tell what another invention does. You ask the Creator of the invention to go, well, what's this purpose for? I think that's the problem with our society right now, is we're asking each other, what's our purpose? And we're running around in circles like a chicken with their head cut off. Because we don't know our purpose. But if you find Jesus and you value him, he will show you your purpose. And that is what these parables are about. For the non-believer, if you stumbled in here, let me tell you something, there will be nothing in life more valuable than what stands before you today. You can go, yeah, that sounds great, but there's probably something better out there. This sounds like all the other denominations out there. This sounds like all the other religions out there. Well, it's something totally different. Because all those are fake and this is true. That's what matters. Or if you're in the man who was in search of something. If you're in here today and you've been searching for some purpose in your life. You've been searching for identity. You've looked through alcohol. You've looked in drugs. You've looked in people. You've looked to give yourself your identity. And you're searching. You're like, you're like this man in this parable. He's searching for great pearls. And then he finds the one. And he's like, yes, that's worth it. If you're in here today and you've found Jesus, and you're like, wow, yes, I've been searching for something, and Jesus is worth it. You know what? I showed up today hoping to hear about something that would give me direction, give me purpose in life, and I have found it. Let me tell you something. It is worth it. In a couple minutes, Glenn and Josh and myself will be up here. We'll be able to tell you more about Jesus Christ, give you some direction of where to go from here, how to accept him as your Lord and Savior. Start that process of becoming his. But if you're a Christian in here today and you have forgotten the true value of Jesus Christ, let me tell you something from a college student who doesn't have a lot of experience but knows this one thing. When I leave here, it's bittersweet. Bitter because I will miss you guys, but sweet because I know that Jesus is coming with me. I'm not leaving here going, hey, that's so sad because my faith is dead now. No, because my faith is not in this church, but my faith is in Jesus Christ. And as the church, I want to see this church flourish. I want to look back and go, wow, what amazing things First Baptist Iowa Park is doing for the Lord. And you know why? It's because they put nothing in front of Jesus Christ. That's where it begins as a church. And that's where it begins for the Christian. You can look through the Bible and try to fix yourself, but if you don't adore Christ, it's going to fall short. If you don't adore Christ, you can fill your mind with as much knowledge as you want, but if your heart isn't changed and you don't value the Lord as your Savior, then it will fall short, just like everything else. So if that's you tonight, today, and you want to repent, the altar's open for you guys. If you want to join the church, Glenn and Josh will be more than happy to tell you about it. And let me just tell you something from my experience. This church, you won't find a better one out there. This church puts up a good running against my home church, right? I didn't cry leaving my home church, but I will cry leaving this church. Because this isn't just a church, this is a family with God as our Father. There will not be a better church that you can go to. If you're a non-believer out there today, let me tell you something. I spent a couple years of my life searching for other things. And there's plenty of people in this church who will be able to tell you more and more experience that they had searching for their value and their identity and other things. I guarantee you this, we will all agree on this one thing. Nothing compares to our Lord Jesus Christ.